Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is the Steve Jones Show here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve will soon be there from the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Lincoln, Kia, Hyundai, all new pre-owned inventory. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. A lot of drama going on in the sports world in the last 24 to 48 hours or so. Of course, there's the Aaron Rodgers thing. We'll get more to that. Spent a lot, great deal about that yesterday. But then, of course, you see what happened with the Rangers and the Capitals last night. It's for one thing that the NHL... Well, let me start with it this way. Gary Bettman, to me, has been taking a lot of good steps forward as commissioner. To this point, it's been abysmal at best, his tenure. But the way he handled the pandemic, the way he handled negotiating the next contract with the players, the next bargaining agreement, I thought was very commendable. He was very much about what the players were comfortable with, and everything's been good since then. Well, then the Tom Wilson hit on Artemi Panarin comes on Monday night. And, of course, we know how much of a menace Tom Wilson has been. There's no other way to describe it, or else you're just naive. And once again, he just gets an old slap on the wrist from that hit on Panarin. When you know, as an organization, as a league, you have suspended and fined this guy multiple times for dirty hits like this, an unnecessary play like this. I know hockey is going to be known for the fighting and the rough play, but there has to come a time where the league needs to draw a line. And why they haven't been able to draw a line for all this time on a guy like Tom Wilson, I will never understand. But it's gotten to a whole new level now with what they just did to the New York Rangers today after what happened last night. So they put out the statement, you know, ripping the fine that the league gave Tom Wilson, and then they also ripped the removal of the department of the director of player personnel in the NHL. And the fine of today is an absolute joke, bottom line. And Gary Bettman's taking a big step back for me. It's an absolute joke to fine the Rangers for putting out something that, actually the NHL might want to look at here.
They got personal about it. You don't call for somebody to be fired. That's what the Rangers did wrong. They called for his firing.
But they're not wrong, though, in calling for him. I mean, in public? Okay, maybe. But okay, let's look at the facts here. Tom Wilson does not deserve to be in the NHL. He does not.
Right, but you don't publicly call for an official in the league to be fired. Okay? Internally, if you want to talk to Gary Bettman about it, you know, but you don't do it in public. That's what the fine is about, the public part. Okay, that is, when it got personal, that is why they got fined. Not for the stand the Rangers took. It's the part about calling for him to be canned. And they didn't mince words.
You're right. They didn't.
They used the word fired. Okay, that's why they got fined. Now, let's take this a step further, though. What I don't like, and I've said this for a long time, when somebody makes a decision to do something and then send somebody else out to talk about it, what do you mean send somebody else out to talk about it? You made the decision. You talk about it. So this guy made his decision. I don't care he's with the league office. He should have been on a conference call with the media explaining why he did what he did. He made the decision. Why should he be insulated? He shouldn't be insulated.
Totally agree.
I mean, that's the part that always strikes me. You made the decision. You go explain it. Instead of having now the $5,000 fine, you can't dispute that. That is, there's no disputing that. That is the maximum you actually can be fined in the NHL based on the basic agreement for this. So that actually is the max. So that's off the table. That can't even be discussed. Suspending him? Now, do I think he should have been suspended? Yeah. But the $250,000 fine is calling for him to be fired. No. That part in public you can't do. I mean, what would happen to the guy if he said, well, fine, now obviously two of the Rangers personnel were fired this week. But I think John Davidson should be fired. Well, somebody in the league can't do that. And so now think about it in reverse. They can't do that with him either. That's not how it works. And that's why they got fined. The fine was not for being upset about it. The fine was calling for the personnel to be fired. That's what it's about. But I also think that you make a decision like that, I don't care if it's the NFL, the NBA, NHL, whatever. But to me, you make decisions. Guess what? You're on a conference call, on a Zoom, with the media in Washington, the media in New York. And you discuss. Maybe only take five or six questions, but at least you talk about it. What did you see? Why did you see? Why no suspension? Instead of like being insulated, you make decisions. You should be accountable for it. And that's what. That part always bothers me. You make a decision, somebody else goes out and explains it. No, you made the decision, you go out and explain it. And that's the way it should be. You made the decision. I can't sit there, like, I have to represent you, but, like, I got to read your mind? What the? That's, so they put out a press release. Here's a press release. Well, explain it. That was what was so interesting about what happened this week with the governor and the May 31st thing. They put out a press release. There was no press conference to explain what everything meant. What about sports? What do you think? There was no Q&A. Now, the governor was here yesterday. Kept looking over his shoulder toward Danville. It's like a found that to be. Did you find that uncomfortable?
The constant like looking. S-U-I-T. That spells suit.
The suit never explains to us what his decisions are. And I'm okay with that. Because the explanations are very long and convoluted, and you and I don't have that kind of time. Nobody has that kind of time. Albert Pujols' career as an LA Angel is over. 10 years, $240 million. Doesn't mean he can't play. Doesn't mean he can't play for somebody else, but they won't owe him $24 million. The Angels are paying the $24 million. He can be signed for the minimum by anybody. Now, obviously, the minimum by anybody is going to be the American League. There's no way in the planet he can play in the National League. There's no way. That's... So it had to be an American League team. But he had 667 home runs in his career? How about that phenomenal number? 667 home runs in his career. You're talking about, I mean, to his credit, one of the truly great right-handed hitters in the history of the game. Now, the contract with the Angels, I've talked about this once, I've talked about it many, many times, not his contract, but contracts in general, that idealistically, I feel you should probably not give a position player more than 5 years, and idealistically, you should not give a pitcher more than 3 years. Now, under my plan, my team would get destroyed because Ronald Acuña Jr. would sign with somebody else, Lindor would sign with somebody else. Pujols would sign with somebody else. I mean, you name it. You know, Harper would have signed with somebody else. I just wouldn't want to give more than 5 years. And I said this about, remember, we talked about Dustin Pedroia retiring, about his 8-year deal. I said, look, I never would have given him more than five. You don't know what's going to happen. I mean, Harper got hit in the face the other day. Okay. Now, fortunately, Harper's okay. But you don't know what fluke thing is going to happen to any athlete. You just don't know. We'll take a break. Come back with more in a moment. Great to have you with us today on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by our good friends at Sunbury Motors.
Out and Garnered Hathaway, they combined for 2 goals, 3 assists.
There we go.
Right off the faceoff, 3 fights simultaneously. Rooney and Dowd. DiGiuseppe going at it with Hathaway, Blackwell, and Haglin. 1 second in.
First off, classy move by Blackwell. He had Haglin down and he didn't throw an extra punch. Hathaway and DiGiuseppe are really getting after one another.
Kenny Albert, Pierre McGuire last night. There were 6 fights in the opening 4-14 of that. By the way, Kenny Albert and Ed Olczyk will go to TNT as their number one broadcast team. I would throw that in there for you.
Good move on their part.
Oh, it's the move we expected, but yeah, it's a great move on their part. Very smart. But yeah, there was 6 fights opening 4-14. There was 141 minutes of penalties last night. It's the kind of stuff that attracted the suit initially to hockey.
So you, sir, are my hero!
I said, what about the goal scoring and the skill? Blank look. Scary.
F-O-U-L-E-D, that spells foul duh.
Yeah, they did a lot of foul does last night.
Just a little.
Pulled 667 home runs. He also grounded into 403 double plays, the all-time record in the history of baseball. 403 double plays he grounded into. Wow. It's a lot. But it's a Hall of Fame career. He's one of the, you know, 298 career hitter. You want Tom Wilson out of the game.
I do. I've said that for a while now.
I don't understand. He speaks very highly of you.
as I said right before you jumped on, he has been a menace to the game.
Well, the game is so different now compared to days gone by. Just so different now. Just is. And it's about space. It's about skill. Now, it doesn't mean, it does not in any way, shape, or form, it does not mean that guys aren't as physical or whatever. Look at all the guys that, by the way, get to the ice and block shots. I mean, there are a lot of guys looking to sacrifice themselves. So that part's different. Hey, Willie Mays is 90 years old today. 90 years old.
Wow.
Obviously, the consummate, quote, five-tool player. And not only that, but about as smart a baseball player as you're ever going to see. Oh, played the brain, played the game not only with his legs, arms, but played it with the gray matter up top. Incredible player. 660 home runs. The only oddity about Mays, though, Mays was not a great postseason player. He made the great catch in the 54 World Series. But with, you know how many home runs Mays hit in the postseason in his career? None. I saw a picture of you and the dog today.
That's right. He was back in the building.
First of all, Bullers looks good. Bully looks good.
Yeah.
Okay. Looks really good. All right. Kind of reminds me of the German Shepherds in Hogan's the Heroes, where they're all friendly to the prisoners. He's friendly with everybody in the staff. The only person he growls at is in the corner. Well, okay. No, he's Uncle Kev the Bully. Right? He's Uncle Kev the Bully, right?
Oh, yeah. Always. He's friendly with everybody. Everybody loves him here back.
That's funny because behind Michelle's back, that's now how Kevin talks. Oh, I wasn't supposed to reveal that?
Whoops.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motor Kia, routes 11 and 15. Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Lincoln, Kia, Hyundai, best in the business. Fabulous pre-owned inventory as well that has the Sunbury Motors guarantee. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Steelers tight end Pat Freiermuth scheduled to be our guest tomorrow on the show. By the way, the suit does love Bullers the dog, right? Which shows you how lovable that animal is. Because, I mean, that heart has frost warnings.
You, sir, are my hero!
What bothers me is that, you know, I break all the news this week and you put the dog in charge of the news this week. What's the deal?
Desperate times call for desperate measures.
It's like one person in the station breaks any news and it's like, okay, fine, it's the dopey sports guy. All right, so... Let's get to name, image, and likeness now. As you recall, earlier in the week, I talked about it's called the advantage, and that's Alabama. You know, this goes with what Duquesne's doing. And now, why did I talk about Alabama with their program called The Advantage. As you know, was the opportunity to take advantage of name, image, and likeness. Well, guess what? Name, image, and likeness goes into play in Alabama in, let's say, the 6th, 55 days. I'm sorry, my apologies. 55 days. That's when it goes into effect. That's why they put it out there. So here are the states that have laws now in place, and then I'm going to talk about the states where the legislative process is underway. See how many states we got here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So 12 states have laws in place. We'll explain how it works. And 14 have bills actively moving through the legislative process, including Pennsylvania. So it's 26 states. So let's get to it. Alabama. Alabama passed the name, image, and likeness law last month. It goes into effect July 1st. Arizona passed their bill, and these are all passed and signed by the respective governors. Kay Ivey, the governor of Alabama, signed that law and now signed it last month. It goes into effect July 1st. Arizona passed it in March, goes into effect, though, July 23rd. Why July 23rd? I don't know. It was an odd date, but maybe that's when Arizona and Arizona State in Northern Arizona go back to school. I don't know. But July 23rd for Arizona. Arkansas passed their bill last month. Governor Asa Hutchinson signed it last month. It goes into effect on January 1st, 2022. We all know California was the first. In fact, we really started kicking this into a higher gear talking about it when California passed it in September 2019. But as we pointed out then, and it has not changed, the law in California on name, image, and likeness, the ability to take advantage of it, still does not go into effect until January 1st, 2023. Colorado passed their bill on name, image, and likeness 14 months ago, March of 2020. It goes into effect on January 1st, 2023. So it doesn't go into effect now for another 19 months. Florida, and this is the one that we've talked about a lot as a benchmark. Florida passed their bill a year ago, almost a year ago, June 2020. It goes into effect July 1st. So they were the first ones to have it go into effect July 1st. That's what put the pressure on the NCAA to come up with something, what Florida did. California put some pressure on it, but because it was January 1st, 2023, it allowed time. When Florida passed their bill last year, 11 months ago, because it went into effect July 1st this year, it put more pressure on the NCAA. Now, others have obviously followed suit. Georgia, this week, passed their bill, and Governor Brian Kemp signed it, and it goes into effect July 1st. Michigan passed their bill in December of last year. Governor Gretchen Whitmer signed it, but it doesn't go into effect until December 31st, 2022. So again, same story. Doesn't go into effect for 19 months. Mississippi passed their bill last month. Governor Tate Reeves signed it, and it goes into effect July 1st. I know I'm just a dopey sports guy. I shouldn't know who the governors of these states are. Matt, sorry. I feel like I'm trespassing on your...
No, it is all good. I knew that you knew some of the governor names.
I actually emceed an event for the National Governors Conference once.
Really?
Yes.
Hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I learned something new every day.
Mm-hmm. I did. When Pennsylvania hosted it, the governor asked me to emcee it, so I did.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
So that would have been who? What governor at the time with that?
Ridge.
Okay.
Ridge. Did I ever tell you the follow-up story on the Ridge thing?
I don't believe you have, no.
So Governor Ridge's office asked me to MC this thing, and it was great. I had a great time. I mean, I get to, you know, got to meet a lot of, you know, you had a couple of governors at your table and so forth. And Mike Huckabee was the governor of Arkansas at the time. Huge sports fan. God, did I love talking to him. He loves sports. And so then they gave essentially Pennsylvania's version of the Medal of Freedom, whatever it's, you know, and they gave it to Joe, and I was invited to the governor's mansion as a guest, you know, right, to be a part of it, which was really a cool thing. You know, I mean, to watch that one, I just watched. I wasn't a part of anything. I was just there as, you know, I'm the announcer for Penn State football. Well, when Joe passed Bear Bryant's record, 324, one of the TV stations asked to interview me about the accomplishment, and they wanted to do the interview on the field. It was cold that day. So I'm walking through the tunnel going out onto the field with Gary Sinderson from Channel 6. And this guy with, there's two guys walking toward me, and one guy had a white parka and the hood was up over. He goes, "Hey, Steve, how you doing?" I go, "Hey, how are you?" Jerk. Right? And Gary says, "Well, you're awfully cavalier with the director of Homeland Security." I go, "Oh my God." I said, "Tom," I said, "I'm sorry, I didn't see your face." He goes, "Steve, how could you? Nobody could see me in here."
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
I'm like, I had to yell back to him. He goes, "Oh, geez, don't worry about it." I felt 2 inches tall. I was like, "You're such a jerk." Oh, Stevie, you're a jerk. All right. So Mississippi then passed their law last month. Governor Tate Reeves signed it, goes into effect July 1st. Nebraska passed theirs July of last year. Now, it goes into effect no later July 1st, 2023, but schools can implement the new policy anytime they want. So if Nebraska wants to do it starting July 1st, the University of, they can do it. New Jersey passed their law in September. Governor Phil Murphy signed it. It goes into effect, but it doesn't go into effect until September 2025. Which, you need time to think about it? What? New Mexico, which is obviously a major power in athletics in the country, passed their bill last month. I believe, is it Governor Martinez? Sound right? I think. Goes into effect on July 1st. So what you see in here is, starting on July 1st, six SEC teams, Alabama, Auburn, Mississippi, Mississippi State, Florida, and Georgia, all have name, image, and likeness. A seventh SEC team, Arkansas, has it going into effect just 6 months later on January 1st. In the Big Ten, New Jersey's not a factor. Does it go into effect until 2025? Nebraska can be a factor. They looks like they can go into effect whenever they want. But notice the advantages that are lining up here. Now, here are the states with bills in the legislative process. Pennsylvania is one, and the legislative process is moving along to be passed this year. That's where it is. Here are the other 13 states that are in the legislative process. Iowa's in the process of doing it this year. Kansas is 2022. Maryland's 2023. Massachusetts is 2022. Montana's 2023. Nevada is 2022. New York is this year. North Carolina, I was surprised about this, 2024. Oregon is this year, Pennsylvania this year, Rhode Island 2022. This one really surprised me. Tennessee 2023, West Virginia this year, and now here's the one that surprises me more than any of them. Texas is 2023. That one really, really surprised me. I thought Texas would be one of the first. obviously, this can all become a moot point if Congress passes legislation. Now, as we all know, Senators Cory Booker and Richard Blumenthal, Booker from New Jersey and Blumenthal from Connecticut, introduced legislation back in December about an overhaul to NCAA rules. Okay. But it was February of this year that Senator Chris Murphy of Connecticut, and Murphy is a big sports fan, and Congresswoman Lori Trahan from Massachusetts introduced federal legislation that would create a completely unrestricted market for college athlete endorsement deals. Now, the Supreme Court heard oral arguments on the Alston versus NCAA antitrust lawsuit on March 31st. I would think that when the rulings start to come out, and usually, now Matt, correct me on this, usually we start hearing about rulings in the Supreme Court right around the end of this month or June, correct?
I believe it is at the end of the month.
Again, I'm just the dopey sports guy. I'm not supposed to know this stuff.
I am not 100%, but I believe you are correct.
But I'm just the dopey sports guy. I'm
I'm half a dopey sports guy, so there you go.
So we'll find out what the ruling is there. And that's when you, and by the way, when the NCAA was before the Supreme Court and it was Q&A time, they got a lot of questions. And the Alston side did not get the questions. The NCAA side got almost all the questions. And even justices that are normally, in a listening mode, like Justice Clarence Thomas. Nope. Thomas was out there asking questions. He had a lot of them. Amy Coney Barrett had a lot of them. Elena Kagan, who usually asks a lot of questions, along with Justice Sotomayor, usually they asked a lot. But questions were coming from all angles, and they were all for the NCAA. It's one thing about, you want to make sure that you have a solid lifelong retainer. Have the NCAA as a client. The funnel of cash in the direction of your law firm, it is a constant deal. They are involved in a lot of legal cases. All right, we'll take a break. Great to have you with us today on the show. Glad to know the dog is doing great and is in the building today. Got his picture taken with Matt. Dog looked happy.
He did. I like bowlers.
Well, I know you do. Everybody does. Everybody does. Even the coldest of cold hearts. All about cash. love the dog. Back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle's worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
So I was telling Matt that tonight is a State College Quarterback Club board meeting. So this is the board making decisions for the upcoming year and so forth, discussing how we're going to go about things. How are we going to do the quarterback club luncheons? What about the banquet? Things like that. So I was telling Matt one thing. I sit there and I'm like, You know me when it comes to meetings. It's like having water drip on my forehead. And it's like, oh, what are we doing? So I'm sitting there one night. We were at the, now this time it's being done by Zoom. But, and it was done by Zoom last year too. But I'm sitting at the Nittany Lion Inn. And this gigantic table. And it's like four sides, and it takes up the entire room. So I'm at the opposite end of the people running the meeting. And look, the quarterback club board has a lot of great people in it. But you know with me, he's like, just get to the point. Let's vote. Let's get out of here. It's like, come on. Let's go.
Yes.
Right. And finally, they were discussing the last meeting's minutes. And part of the point of order is, for example, everything has to be voted upon. That includes last meeting's minutes, which the last meeting we had was in August of the year before. So I'm sitting there like, this is just driving me. So all in favor of putting into the last meeting's minutes, aye. All against, no. They said, you voted no in the minutes? I said, yeah, why? Because I could. I said, do you need a unanimous vote to have the minutes passed? No. I said, we'll put it down as 21-1.
F-O-U-L-E-D, that spells foul.
They said, why did you do that? I said, to be funny. I said, there's no laughter in this room. That was the only reason I did it, was just to get people to laugh. So I voted no in the minutes. Nobody ever votes no in the minutes. I said, did some of you laugh? Yeah, I said, that's what I wanted. That's all I cared about. I won't do that again. Because then I had to spend 2 minutes in wasting time explaining why I voted no. I said, I'm not here to waste time. Hey, by the way, Wayne Gretzky, they are pitching to Wayne Gretzky to be an analyst for ESPN's hockey.
That would be amazing.
Hopefully. I mean, again, to me, you have to be... Take, for example, is Eddie Olczyk one of the greatest players of all time? No. But is... Eddie Olczyk was a really good player. He's one of the best American players ever. He was a terrific player. But is he Gretzky, Howe, Hall? No. But on the air, he's terrific. Yeah, so it sometimes the Hall of Famer can be great. I think John Smoltz is really good on baseball. Chris Collinsworth is not a Hall of Famer. Really good, though. Tony Romo, probably not a Hall of Famer. Aikman is. But, yeah, but Gretzky could very well be an outstanding. I mean, he could very well be an outstanding analyst, but I don't know. That's why the part about Peyton Manning is so interesting. Everybody wants Manning, they want Manning, they want Manning. And Manning could be phenomenal. But you won't know until he actually gets out there and has to start breaking down a game in short increments. I mean, listen how Jack Ham breaks down a game, or how Dick Girardi breaks down a game. There is an incredible skill to doing that in the limited time that you have to do it. I realize I give logical answers. I understand. You hate that.
Sometimes it's warranted.
Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors on News Radio 1070 WKOK.